Hello and good afternoon. Today our presenter is Christopher McDonald, exploring the standards for boundary evidence on Indian trust lands. For 10 years, Christopher McDonald worked for the Bureau of Land Management as a cadastral surveyor in Alaska, Arizona, and now New Mexico, where he is the BLM Indian Land Surveyor Bills for Southern Plains region. He is the primary BLM contact for BIA employees at the regional and agency offices, as well as for tribal governments and individual Indians in the Southern Plains region concerning the PLSS legal description and land tenure issues. Conduct legal description examination for realty action conducted by the BIA, review of legal descriptions in accordance with DOI standards for the Indian Trust land boundary evidence, and welcome.
First of all, let's give Ryan a round of applause. He's worked very hard on putting this whole conference together. Their staff has dwindled over the past few years, and he's done an excellent job of keeping everything going.
Thank you. And we are recording this, so if there are any questions or comments, I will bring the microphone to you so you can speak into it. Thank you.
All right, you guys ready? Can you all hear me? I was hoping for a lapel mic so I can move around and be a little more comfortable. So, as the BLM Indian Land Surveyor for Southern Plains, I have a large range of duties. And one of them that's not on there is I get to cook a lot. They enjoy having me cook at some of their events and stuff. I'm a pretty good cook. Don't win any awards, but I'm a decent cook. So I help the tribe, the region, everybody interpret the BLM records, understand the survey, hit survey problems, a number of things. You know, they come to me questions on boundary issues, trespass issues, everything like that, outreach, doing presentations like this. So, some of the ground rules. If you guys participate, this will go a whole lot better. Ask questions, you know, just have a good time. We do that, you learn a lot better. You know, the presentation goes a lot better. Ask for clarification if something is unclear to you. This is very important. Anytime that you talk to anybody, if you don't understand, ask the question. Because if you're not understanding, you're gonna walk out of that room and miss the point, especially talking to your realty officer or your land surveyor. We speak different languages and we have to use the same dictionary. So if I say something that's unclear or ambiguous to you, stop and say, hey, Chris, I didn't understand that. I had a meeting with somebody and I kept using a term over and over and it was ambiguous to them, they didn't know. And he says, hey, explain me that. And I explained it to him. And my perception of that person went way up because he stopped the meeting and asked for clarification so he could understand. And when he got back to his office, he knew exactly what I was talking about and had a good idea of where we were going. And if he didn't do that, we would have had issues down the road because communication and that relationship is very important. And on that note, let's try not to interrupt each other and monopolize the time. I'm going to speak in general terms about this because every tribe, every region, every person, every transaction is different. And how one person does it or perceives to do it is totally different than how someone else does it. So I expect to get phone calls, you know, in a couple months. Well, Chris McDonald said this from the other bills, you know. So we're going to try to hit general terms and keep it, you know, that way. So the objectives, why are we here? So we're just lightly touch the history of why we have these standards, 303 DM7. Understand where my guidance comes from when I start doing the LDRs, the certificate of inspections, and the chain of surveys. And I say LDRs, it's legal description review, and I forget that not everybody's familiar with that acronym. one thing that comes up is, I have title insurance on this. I'm going to touch on that very quickly. Understanding the primary source of boundary standard evidence, and then understanding the secondary source. And I mainly work with a secondary source. This, I'm going to talk about this one, but I'm going to mention this one because it's kind of the same thing. This is eyes and boots on the ground throughout the whole presentation, or throughout the whole process. This is you and me working together to do it from my office and the tools that I will use to do that. So the goals of this is to reduce cost, evaluate the risk, and to tell you the risks involved with a transaction or the legal description or the use of the land. Streamline it, try to get it moving. Sometimes it doesn't seem like it. When we have issues, they will draw out. And determine the degree of the boundaries and the economical matter. The SBEs or the certificates that I'll talk about, it's not a survey. It's trying to get to the survey from an office standpoint without having the actual survey done. So it's not as good. That's why it's a secondary source and not the primary source. Any questions? So when I'm talking about these two, I'm going to intermingle them because it's kind of doing the same thing, but two different views of it. So the government decided or realized, hey, we have issues that are going on. And it's not just in Indian country, it's all over, whether it's Forest Service, Fish and Wildlife, and the private sector. These issues go on. When it comes to Native American interests, the fiduciary trust model, it's bigger, especially with boundaries, because if we bring into something a trust, it may take an act of Congress to fix it. So we want to make sure it's correct prior to bringing it into trust or prior to doing a transaction, whether it's leasing or rights away or anything like that. So 2004, they brought in the fiduciary trust model. Then comes 303 DM7 in 2007, and that sets the guidance and brought me into place, and not since 2008, but it brought the bills into place, is getting a senior land surveyor into the regions to help them with all these boundary issues. Real quick on title insurance, I think this slide's very important. It talks to a couple things. When do you get title insurance? Anybody? When you first buy the property, correct? Title insurance goes against the title. It does not go against the boundary defects. So if you have issues out there, you have unrecorded rights away or adverse possession, it doesn't protect against them. It just protects things on the title. Something that I need you to take home with you, I really want to take home with you, is you're buying this to protect yourself. I want you to think about these processes I'm talking about when you purchase a property, because I'm here protecting the U.S. government, I'm protecting the tribe, and I'm protecting BIA when I do these risk assessments. That's great, but what's the flaw in that? There's a big flaw in that. Anybody? You guys already own the property. If there's something wrong with it, guess what? You own it. You know, when I bought my piece of property, it was lot 24 of this subdivision. So, me being a surveyor, of course, I pull up the plat, look at it, lot 24. Wait a minute, 1.003 acres. Wait a minute. When I went to buy that from the real, when I went to the realtor, it was 1.334. Wait a minute, that's false advertisement. go to the realtor and says, hey, this is incorrect. Where'd you get your information? Did you get it from the assessor site? Well, yes. Well, the assessor site's wrong. He says, well, no, I pulled the plat up. I pulled the documentation up, and here's what it is. And it really set her to the side. It's like, and the market's coming up big time. And she's like, well, we can sell to somebody else. And I says, you sell to somebody else, I'm going to make sure that they know that they bought 1 acre and not three. And they ended up selling it to me. Whenever you bring something into trust or you buy it, the primary thing is when it comes into trust, you cannot have defects in the title. That has to be researched and done. Because once it's in, it's in. We now have to get Congress involved. And right here they're telling you, where is it? Somewhere in here it says what a survey would pick it up. So they're telling you right there, in when you're getting that title insurance, hey, you really ought to have a survey done. Or we're giving you the other option of the standards of boundary evidence, those four certificates. So right there, you know, the title insurance are telling you yourself that you need to think about these when you're purchasing the property. And that's the perfect time to do it. You're negotiating that deal. Hey, I want a survey, or I want to do the boundary standard evidence in that 30 days.
I just wanted to clarify that the exceptions you're talking about are for standard title policy insurance.
Right.
So the tribe that I work for, we do get a survey whenever we acquire property, and then get extended title policy. So perfect. Those exceptions do come off title. So that is something to think about if, as you guys move forward with acquisitions, is there are options for title insurance to get those exceptions off. You have to pay for that, obviously, but then you do have more assurance towards the boundaries of the properties before you move forward towards trust.
Very good point. And that reminds me, I was working with a tribe, and in doing the standards of boundary evidence, we uncovered those and went to the title company, hey, we want these. Oh, we know about those. You didn't buy the extra policy. So they already knew about it. They just weren't going to show you that there were issues on that. You know, they are in the business to make money. So the guidance. You can pull this up online, 303-DM-7, and I've got all kinds of tabs on it because I try to quote from this. I try to follow this to my ability every time. And when I speak to it, I'll pull it out and show you right here where it says. I don't try to memorize it because every time you memorize it or something, you put a little bit of spin on it. So I always, when somebody comes in my office, I pull this out, go to the tab and say, hey, here's where they say this. Our kind of Bible is the 2009 BLM manual. That's the current manual. And in there, it calls for the specifications of legal land descriptions. And I will refer to this whenever we're doing the review and how it should be. And all of these are available online, and we still have some of these at our booth. So I suggest you pick them up. And then on the back table, I was going to mention this earlier, and of course I forgot. There are some handouts with the principal meridians in there, the public room, and the bills. And on the back side of the bills, the Indian land surveyor names is the cadastral chiefs. And that's who we report to. So the guidance, as we're going through it, like I said earlier, the primary source is land surveyor. That's eyes and boots on the ground. We want to make sure the boundaries are identified and not ambiguous. Anybody get caught up on that word ambiguous? We want to make sure there's only one meaning to that legal description. It cannot say, well, maybe it's this or maybe it's that. It's got to be one answer. It's got to be legally defensible. We want to make sure there's no unauthorized use, encroachments, gaps and lapse, and conflicts. So primary source, land survey. The secondary mode is where I really come into play, is the LDR, land description review, the chain of survey. I'm not going to talk about this one a whole lot. It's not widely used in a lot of the regions. It needs to be. It's one of those that people don't understand it. And some states didn't have a good recording act. When a survey's done, it was recorded, so they're a lot harder to find. So it makes that difficult. It's a good resource, and I've only done a couple of them. And then a certificate of inspection and possession. So that's getting a little bit of the boots on the ground when you go out and do those. Any questions, anything on that? So, not all surveys are the same. The top one, official cadastral BLM survey. BLM only surveys when there's federal interest in a piece of land or going to be federal interest in it. We are highly educated and schooled in the federal way of doing it. And that's different than each state and region and things like that. So we have to know the federal rules. Then we also have to know how and when to apply state rules and other rules in there. So our expertise is a little different. Anytime you have a conflict on federal interest lands, you're probably going to want a BLM survey on it, especially when it comes to the boundary. There's a little joke between Forest Service and BLM. Whenever a Forest Service boundary is in conflict, the Forest Service surveyor can only survey the private side of the line and not the federal side of the line. It's the same line, but they survey under their state license and not federal authority. That's when they get us involved. And the same thing with Indians, Indian lands, things like that. They don't have the authority to change or update the record. And that is where we come into. And the second one is the American Land Title Association, ALTA survey. So that's when you get Schedule A and Schedule B and pick out the things that you need done. It's below the federal authority survey. It's done under state license. It's done in the state portion of it. So there's usually no federal interest done in it. And I want to hit CFEDs real quick. CFED certified federal surveyors, they have been trained to work toward the federal standards. They're educated into it to a degree. They have no more authority unless it's given from BLM. So they can do any of these, but to do this one, they have to have assignment instructions, and BLM has a 14-step process to get a federal authority survey done. And the CFEDs can do it, and there's been a few states that has done it. But when working in Indian country or Indian interest lands, the CFEDs are trained to understand some of the special needs to do or that are needed to get things done. So they understand some of the federal laws or most of the federal laws to get that done. Any state authority surveyor can do that if they're educated in it and if you have that relationship and know what they need or know what you need. These really come into play, the ALTA, especially if there's business in it, you're going to have a high rise or whatever it is, it's, you know, development, you know. The third one is just a survey done under state authority. Maybe it's rangeland and or something like that. It's just the surveyor going out to open ground or whatever, and he's doing it. It's not as complicated. There's a fourth one that I don't have on that list. That we don't like to talk about, and that's the no authority survey. That's just, hey, I had a year of surveying class or I helped one, and I take the information and I think your corner is there, there, and there, and draw it up and give it to you. It's not done under state authority. It's not done under anything. And unfortunately, that happens a lot. And unfortunately, it's happened a lot on reservations and Indian lands, things like that. And so, any questions? So the primary source of survey is the surveyor out on the ground. Even though the buildings or improvements are not taken into trust, they are on that property. And they have to be identified and they have to be shown. And a lot of times I'll get a boundary survey in there that won't show those. And they need to be shown so you can reference them to the boundary and other issues. And one of the things you'll see up here is this came straight out of 303. They should be prepared. We can't tell you that. We can highly recommend that you have this done. So anytime you're creating new lots, anything like that, boundary issues with complex and confusing title, yes, we need to be involved. Litigation, anything like that. Encroachments or right-of-way, yes, you want those surveyed. You want those identified. A land surveyor's job. Locate the title lines, and show the relationship and possession against the title lines. He does not declare ownership of the lands or who has the right to use the lands, the possession of it. That's when the attorneys get involved. And what I'm saying there is you may have the deed that says, I own this piece of property. That's a piece of property that I own. Great. But right here, you have a gentleman that has been farming this piece of property for 20 years. We now have a conflict in use and occupancy. They may or may not have possession and rights to this land in conflict. That's the surveyor's job to show that. A surveyor's job is unique. You are paying me to do a survey, and you're encroaching on her piece of property. I have to disclose that. I can't, well, he's paying me. I'm not going to overlook that. I can't do that. I have to tell the truth and say exactly what I'd find. If there's a fence line there, there's hedgerow, or if they're farming it, I have to do that research. I have to understand that and put that on the ground, or put that on the plat and show it. Same thing over here. You got a fence line that comes down around here and all of a sudden takes off and comes over here just like this. I have to show that. I have to show that you're encroaching on your neighbor. And especially something going into trust, all those have to be brought in. Because, and if it's not, and it comes into trust, guess what? We may be going to IBLA or something like that on it. You know, there's a strong argument, and I always have this with my realty officer. In certain cases, yes, you can adverse possess against the government if it has come into possession of the government or into trust. And those rights have ripened prior to it coming into trust, they have a legitimate claim. And I guarantee you they'll exercise their rights. So, what did I do with my clicker? There it is. Okay, I got my legal description. I'm gonna go see a surveyor. Here's my legal description. I want a survey.
$3,000.
Here's my legal description.
I'll do it for $1,500.
Perfect. You got the job. When can you start?
Tomorrow.
Perfect. Great. Everything's good. Is it done?
It's done.
Thank you. Wasn't that easy? Yes. Should that have happened? No. That should not have happened. All surveys are not the same. I want you guys to have the communication and the relationship with your surveyor. Surveyor A may have been doing a different type of survey. He may have been thinking Alta. The second surveyor was just going to go out and slam the deed in the ground. What I want you guys to do, and that goes to talking to me when you're doing the LDR, the legal description review, you put in the crest. I want to have that conversation. Here's my legal description. I plan on, there's nothing out here now, I'm going to hay it for 3 years. I am going to bring it into trust to do X. We're going to develop it this way. And in that process, those 3 years, I am going to start the fee to trust the application. So I'm going to need all the adjoiners. I'm going to need all the monuments listed. I want you to have that conversation with the surveyor. And then he should be coming back to you and saying, okay, this is our options. This is the difference. We can do an ALTA, or I know one of my tribes does just a boundary survey at first, but they also know that later on they're going to step up that survey and update it to bring in all that information when it's ready, because they will go out whenever they buy that piece of property, have it surveyed, just do a regular boundary survey, find all the issues or know them, if any, and then start correcting that in that time, then update their survey. And as a deliverable, they say, I need 3 signed plats, I want all the adjoiners or contiguous properties, and I need all this stuff. And they have started all that information. So whenever we do the legal description review, the CIP, all that, hey, you guys are that much ahead. You are paying them to do that job. So sit down and have that conversation with a surveyor, or have it with the bills or anybody prior to going to them and getting all the information and having a good conversation, and not just, hey, I need a bid on a survey. I see that so often. And I do not, as a bills, I do not want to know how much you're paying for the survey. I do not want to be involved in the negotiation portion of it. I will help you understand what you need and what the deliverables will go and how to write the scope of work. And that's important, having a written scope of work on, I want a ALT, I want a boundary survey, then we're going to do an ALTA, and as part of that, I want a fee to trust packet that has all the joiners and all that information in there. That way you can hold their feet to the fire whenever it's done and you don't have all the information. So any questions on that?
Sorry, not a question. Again, just another statement for how things work for our tribe. We do get the ALTA surveys. And when we put in the contract, we send them the Schedule A for them to prepare their scope and quote. And in that, we say that they need to prepare all the survey work that would be able to necessary to be able to get to the boundary evidence certificates. So getting all the donor stuff ready and so forth. And there's also a spot in there to put in other works that you want done. We use GIS, so we put in there that they have to have GIS shapefiles back to us from their survey, along with the easements. So then we can put that into our GIS system when the survey is done, and we can see through the photo maps or whatever where those easements actually lay on the ground for our review later on.
And do you know what GIS stands for? Get it surveyed. I'm serious. Whenever they put that into Esri or any product, the base layer or the controlling layer needs to be the cadastral survey or the monuments on the ground, the CAD NSDI or what used to be the GCDB. It's important to be tied that way. So, So here's some of the things that you know you want to be aware of when you're doing it. You know, boundary issues, creating a new lot, or you subdividing it. And maybe you are going to subdivide it. Maybe you're buying the 40-acre tract and you're going to do cattle grazing for so long, but then you want to break it into three tracts. Have that conversation with them. And the effects of the law with the land survey. I mean, because if you bring up those issues and you know about them, you need to have those taken care of. And a lot of people don't realize that. So the surveyor should be doing all these. When he goes out on the ground, he should be pulling all the adjoiner deeds. And in the LDR process, I'm going to want all the LDR, I want all the contiguous properties or the adjoiner properties, because I'm going to put those into my product and make sure there's no laps and gaps. And he should be doing the exact same thing. He should be going out and measuring all that. So I'm trying to do that in the office. I get in a packet from you guys, and I am putting it into the product I am using and mapping out where each deed goes and how it fits. Because you want all of these lines. When you're doing a survey, you're not just surveying this property. You are surveying any property that touches it. So this one over here, you know, this one over here, same thing. However it looks, you are actually surveying the line between those, and you have to know the relationship. And they should touch. They shouldn't have a lap or gap or anything like that. So the surveyor is putting all that information together and then going out on the ground to make sure it fits. When I do an LDR review, I'm doing the same thing, but I'm in the office. I'm taking your deed, putting it into the product that I use to do the closures and things like that. And then I'm putting all these others in there, rotating whatever I have to do to make sure they match. So as part of the LDR. One of the things, the benefit, and it's why it's the private surveyor or the primary source is surveying, he's out on the ground doing it. He's out on the ground actually measuring it. And I'm in the office putting it all into the product. And then I'm looking on Google Earth or ArcGIS or whatever it is to make sure it fits. Let's say everything looks good in the office to me, but the surveyor goes out and does it. He's actually measuring monuments out here to get into that. And I can't really do that on Google Earth or Arc. I can get kind of close. So he's out here and he comes over here and measures and, hey, this corner should actually be over here. This corner should actually be over here. The deed line per the deed actually looks something like this. It just doesn't quite match up. And with the surveyor being out on the ground, he can actually see that. I can't do that from the office. So that's one of the big difference between the primary. And he's out there at the time walking the line. I am doing it kind of after when we do the certificate inspection, and you'll see that a little bit. And then when the survey's done, you need to go down and sit down and talk with a surveyor and say, hey, are there any issues? What issues are there and how do we correct those, and can we correct those? Because he should have on the survey map if there's encroachments or you're encroaching on somebody else's property or the monumentation is not correct. You need to have that conversation with him and not just get it back. Because too many times I get a call and says, hey, I've got these issues. And it's like, why are you having that conversation with me? You should have had this with the surveyor. So I want you to take the time and have the conversation and have the relationship with the surveyor, with the bills, to get this done. So now here's we're going to talk about the secondary methods. And we've kind of already kind of hit on those. But we're going to go into a little more meats and potatoes on those. I didn't mention, oops, wrong button again. The boundary assurance certificate. So we start out with the LDR, the legal description review, chain of surveys. I've only done two of those in the last year and few months. The certificate inspection, I go out and help on quite a few of those because there is a boundary portion of that that needs to be done, and we'll talk about that here in a little bit. And I didn't have this one listed. I think there's only one region that actually does the boundary assurance certificate. In polling most of the regions, the 12, I think only one of them's doing it. So I'm not really going to hit on that one. So, and this one's kind of, can be a big one for certain things. I've seen some surveys come in and I've seen different iterations of them. And it's always nice to have the original signed sealed one. I know sometimes they change. I've had some that came in and shown boundary conflicts. And then when the LDR packet comes in, it's nice, clean, pretty, with no monuments or anything. It's just all bearings and distances. And of course that raises the red flag for me. So in having that one, I can call the surveyor out a little more and say, hey, what about these issues and why is it not showing up? In doing these, it's business practice, evaluation of a risk. It's not a survey. I'm trying to get as close as I can to a survey without going out and surveying. I'm in the office doing my best, using all the tools I can use for the information that you have provided me to do them. So Google Earth, ArcGIS, any of those. And I remember sitting in the conversation with the person that owns this, and he said, I misspoke. I called this a fence line. And one of the Google Earth, you can go back in time and look. And at one time, I thought there was a fence line there, and it wasn't. The fence line is over here, sorry. Fence line looked like it was over here, and it wasn't. But in all those pictures, I can go back in time and look and see that they have been using that property for over 20 years. And the comment came up, well, that's Google Earth. It's not. But I can take that distance and see how much change it is from what it should be and it is. And I can't tell a few feet. So it has to be a really large encroachment to do it. And I had another one that was just down from the office. The legal description came out down, angle over, back into this. So I'm going around with Google Earth, and I keep coming up over here on my last call. It just didn't make sense. And I walked out the office and I got in my car and I went down there. And there's a fence line. Over here. 30 feet. Encroachment. I could pick that up on Google Earth. And this whole time I'm arguing with the lawyer that, hey, there's something wrong. There's something out there. So I go out there, I take my long tape and I start measuring this. I talked to the landowner. This is all Native American owned. This is a private piece chunked out in there. They've owned it for, I think it was 34 years. So I pull over, this distance is good. I pull over, I come to right here. There's a fence corner. I look over, fence post. Another fence post, fence corner. And I go back into Google Earth and I talk to the landowner and I have that conversation with him. How long has that fence been there? Well, that fence was there, and the fence posts were there when I bought it, 30 years ago. And it's like, okay. So I had to have the conversation with the lawyer. It's, he goes, you can't use Google Earth. I says, Google Earth showed me the problem. I went out and put boots on the ground, pulled the tape over, and yes, there's an issue. Well, you can't adverse possess against the tribes. Wait a minute. It's fee land. Yes, you can. No, it's on reservation land. You cannot adverse possess against Native American on reservation. No, it's fee land. Those rights don't apply then. So we had the argument, and a couple weeks later, I got a phone call. You're right. We need to address those. What are our options? Well, you can quit claim deed this piece over to them, or you can say, hey, we'll pay to have the fence line moved over. And the landowner goes, you know, I would kind of like to keep that. And they came to an agreement that they would have a survey done. This landowner would pay for this survey to call out that portion, and the tribe would quit claim deed that over to them. And a few more things happened, and since the lawyer was involved, it got really convoluted, and it's still not done. But so back to my original portion. It's not a survey. It's the closest thing I can, using all the tools in my toolbox, to get to where we feel comfortable that piece of property is adequate for the use that you are going to do it. So there's different degrees of it. So it's going into fee to trust. My review of it is going to be a lot more rigorous than you are buying it or you're just going to do a lease. If it's going to do a lease, it may not be anywhere near as rigorous. And if there are issues, they may be non-applicable to what you're doing it. So that's the risk assessment that we will have to do on it and have that conversation. And I will put it on the the certificate. So, and I kind of jumped ahead. So the reasons for LDRs is fee to trust. That's one of the biggest workloads in some of the regions. My region, we are not doing a whole lot of those. I wish we were doing a lot more. Rights of way, reservation proclamations, trust to trust, and updating TAMS acreages or errors in there. So that's some of the reasons why we do the LDRs. And like I've said before, and I'll say it again, when you fill out the worksheet or the request, I want to know why. I have to understand what you're doing to use the proper tools and the proper degree to make sure that I'm doing for what you need. I don't want to be doing every one of them as fee to trust when I don't need to put that effort in there and slow the process down. So, any questions or comments? So, why are good land descriptions important? You got to know where your boundaries are. You got to know how to protect your rights. It's essential. You know, you can't develop the land and stuff if you're uncertain on where your lands are. You know, to get a certified title report, LTRO has to know with it. It has to be ambiguous. It can be easily mapped accurately. So good land descriptions into TAMS makes good realty actions. You know, so many times I see bad legal descriptions, you know. Boundary has importance. It has value. So how do we do this? We want to fill out the proper worksheet. Some of us call them worksheets, some of us call reviews. So you're going to take all the information that you had gathered up, and we're going to go over that a little bit, and you're going to submit it to your realty officer, whether it's in the region or agency or wherever. They are going to fill out the proper request or worksheet. They are going to list out what they're going to need. Why am I doing it? Do I need to check the monuments? Do I need to check the GCDB or any of that? Then when I get it, I sign and date, put it in my log, and start on it. When I'm done, I'll review all the documents, I'll sign and date it, then I have to have my cadastral chief review it, and then it's ready to go back to the client. home. The types of descriptions that we review, of course, is the PLS system, aliquot parts, and government lots. Lot and block, so if you have the subdivision or anything like that, that falls under the lot and block. And then meets and bounds. And meets and bounds are the ones that I showed you earlier that really get hairy on the calls, and you have more potential for laps and gaps and issues like that. I personally like to see government aliquot parts in northeast of the northeast or lot one stay lot one. I hate when it goes into meets and bounds because it muddies the water. And I can understand some of the reasons why I'm doing it. So this one's pretty simple because you have the original plat notes or resurveys. It's a lot simpler. Lot and block is kind of the same. You go back to that original source document of the subdivision or whatever, so it's not as convoluted as the meets and bounds, because meets and bounds, we are carving things out, and that's where you get laps and gaps because of, you know, bad calls, you know, somebody types something out and it's got prolonged or whatever it is, or they just did a bad legal description. And, oh God, that happens an awful lot. So right here, this came out straight out of 303. Early in the acquisition is when you want to start doing these. And when did I say you really want to start thinking about it? When you buy the property. I want to protect you guys. Let's protect you guys first. And then as you're moving into trust, all this is going to fall into place. You know, so don't buy that piece of property that nobody wants. It has the title issues, it has the encroachments. Be prepared because, like I said earlier, when you're going out and buying it and you're doing the negotiation, hey, I want to have a survey done on it. Will you split the cost of the survey? Or I'm going to pay for the survey, and if it passes a survey, yes, I'm going to buy it. And if it doesn't pass the survey, we're going to re-talk. We're going to sit down and have a conversation. Hey, these need to be addressed before I purchase it. That is really when you want to do it, you know, because you don't want to buy it and then come to me and say, hey, you have these issues. I can't help you bring it in a trust until these are done. So, I mean, I can't emphasize enough about thinking about this when you buy the property and having the forethought of, this is why I'm buying this property. This is what I'm going to do. Set yourself up for success and not set yourself up for failure by thinking that, hey, everything's good. Because, you know, it sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. It's, you know, what it is. So the worksheet. When they're filling out the worksheet or the request, they are going to tell me why you're doing it. And I'm going to want all the surrounding lands, especially in meets and bounds. So when I'm doing it, I will know that there's no conflicts in it. So I'm going to research the BLM records, or I'm going to have you research the BLM records, the better way of saying it. I can pull up the BLM records easy, but when you bring me the packet, I need you to do all the heavy lifting on searching the private records and stuff like that. One thing that Southern Plains does, and it doesn't always work out that way, is I try to do a consultation. So someone is thinking about doing a process, feed a trust or acquisition or whatever it is, I make myself available for a consultation. And that's when they come in and say, here's what I have. And I start looking at it and I just do a cursory review and say, hey, yeah, this is information is good. I'm going to need this, this, and this. Or we've got a lot more issues and I'm going to need a whole slew of things. And I try to line that out. And that works most of the time. And sometimes it doesn't. So we're going to want all of this information. And part of it is, you know, the condition of the corner mark monuments, the boundary lines, and anything like that. And we'll get into that on the certificate of inspection. So that's some of the things they can check off. And here's the checklist that I use. Not all regions are the same. There's very... So I want the worksheet or the memo or request, however your region says it. I need to know why, what you're using it for. I need the acquisition deed. And then I need the current deed. And this is something I always, of course, the hard copy. I love the electronic version. I want you to send me the Word version. Saves me from typing. I don't want to have to retype that thing. That's when errors come in. So in my region, one person is typing out that legal description, the tribe or the whoever, they send it to the agency. The agency cuts and pastes it into the request memo. No typos. It comes to me in the Word version. I copy and paste it, and if I need to make changes or whatever, it stays consistent. And I send all that stuff back to them. And it saves a lot of time. And that's one of the deliverables you can have from the land surveyor. We had one that it seemed like there was a very big conflict, and it was a foot and a half. They owned both sides of the line, and it was like, hold your one line, and it was very easy. And in that, they called out all the deeds around to make it a good legal description, but the legal description went from a little paragraph to almost a full page. And in talking to the president of the tribe, I says, when you talk to them, make sure you get a digital copy, a Word version of that. And the surveyor was, I didn't realize the surveyor was on the email string. And I hit send, and I walked up to get a drink of water, and I come back, and the land surveyor already sent the Word version to me. And everybody was happy because none of us wanted to retype out that deal. So in here, you'll see the acquisition deed, and then you have the current deed. And what I'm talking about there is if the deed has changed, if you've made changes to it or corrected it or anything has changed. Sometimes it won't, sometimes it will. A lot of times we will have issues with it, so they will prepare a new deed and we will push that one forward. So that's the current deed, unrecorded or recorded, that they're going to push forward, and that's going to be on the request or the worksheet. I'm going to want all the adjoiners so I can make sure there are no laps and gaps. I got to have the title commit and insurance, and a lot of times I need a 50-year chain of title. And what that does is show the progression on how the property has changed, because a lot of times things will fall off. I remember being in Oregon, and we were doing the chain title. And about, I don't remember how many years ago, during one of the transactions, an easement fell off that chain of title and didn't show up on the title report. It was a 250-foot wide electrical corridor right through the middle of the property. And that came up in the chain of title. And we did the call to the title insurance and says, hey, we have an issue. You know, the tribe now has an issue. You guys didn't find it. So the tribe had to go back, and I think they made a claim against those guys. Just a little short story. Me and my father didn't get along as a kid. I was a snotty-nosed brat and still am. But I became a surveyor, and he had a piece of property that he had bought. And he sold it four times it fell through. And I think he made $50,000 between the four times it fell through and then when he finally sold it. But we had an issue with the title commitment, because when he first started to sell it, I says, Dad, there's a 33-foot easement across the front. I says, no, Chris, there's not. I says, Dad, I know Arizona. I know Maricopa County. The county took 33 feet each side of the section line. in 1909. So right off the bat. And he goes, well, it doesn't show up on the title report, and this is wrong. So a year later, when we sold the property again, because the other one fell through and we made $10,000 on that one, woohoo! Lo and behold, the 33 feet comes up. It's like, Dad! Title companies try to do their best. They don't always do it. And that's why it's important, is to do the abstract and get that back. That's just protecting you. Especially when you're buying it, you know. You can make that part of the package when you're doing it. So, then we want all the survey records that we can find. Some states it's easier, other ones not. And hard copies with the original signature. That may or may not be important. I noticed some of the bills, they want that original. And in some circumstances, I also want the original when looking at a survey, because I have to verify it's true. Same thing on the adjoiners. I don't want right off the assessor's site. I don't want the assessor's information. I want a copy of the recorded deed, because the assessor, just like we talked about earlier, you know, have an electronic version. Whenever they type it into the assessor site, they may miss something, and it happens. I reviewed one, they missed the second call. And the tribe's like, nope, the assessor, no. If you want me to use the assessor site, I can fail it right now because the second call is not in there. We like to have, to make sure that we have the recorded information. And then a side note, you can record anything. You can record a bad deed or anything like that. And that goes back to this one, is having that, because people have changed legal descriptions or information on that throughout the time, and having that abstract back to make sure it doesn't happen. We had an incident in Arizona where we had a highway coming through, and right here was a little chunk of land that somebody had bought. And they wanted this piece over here. Well, this piece was actually owned by BLM. The developer thought he could buy that piece. So he wrote a legal, he went to the surveyor, wrote a legal description. Poor surveyor, you know, he goes, here's the legal description, go out and survey it. Surveyor goes out, surveys it, surveys this, writes up a legal description, goes down to the county, records it. Great. They start approaching BLM. Hey, we want to buy that. Well, we can't sell that to you. It's public land. Okay. Meanwhile, county's got it. County's charging them taxes on all this now. They're happy. You know, first year goes by good. Second year goes by not so good. You know, they don't want to pay it. 7 years later, it goes up for tax sale. Individual out of Texas buys it. Got a recorded deed. But they don't have title to it. And we argued a long time and says, show us the chain of title for this property. They could only find chain of title for this one. They couldn't find chain of title for that one. So they come back to us and says, show us the chain of title. So I go into the back room and get a copy of the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. There's our treaty. That's when we first got it. We purchased it from Mexico. You know. But you can record everything, anything. So that's where the chain of title come in. And it is a pain, and it is costly. But it's very important to make sure that you are having all the rights on that piece of property that you're thinking about buying. And once again, you want to do this when you're purchasing it. You want to really think about this when you're purchasing it. Protect yourselves first. So now we got the legal description in my office, and I'm doing the review. I put down the date I received it, the legal description, all that information, and I have three check boxes that I can use. And I'm not afraid to use any of these. I know some of the bills that do not like to use this one. First one, it's acceptable as written, see comments below. And sometimes I don't have any comments because a lot of times working with the tribes, we get it correct and there are no issues. And sometimes there's a little bit, so I will make the comment. Second checkbox, this has potential problems. So in doing my review, let's go back to this other one. And this didn't happen, but I want to use it for example. I am going to write on this one. I'm going to talk about that fence line. I'm not talking about this. I am going to say, hey, this legal description is good, but it has these issues. There is a fence line on the neighbor's land by a couple feet, and I'm going to document that in the comments down here and say, hey, this has potential issues. Or another one that I hate to bring up is this basis of bearing is unassumed, and I'm checking this box because cadastral wants it on astronomic north or true north or in reference to the true meridian. And let's say it's on assumed bearing, but I have enough information in the legal description and survey to get it to astronomic north. I can check this box and say, hey, yes, it has these issues and they're minor, and I will tell them the degree of it. Or this box that I hate to use because we have failed is this has problems and should not be used as written, and it can be overridden by the BIA or the authorizing officer. Hold on a second.
I just have a quick question. Say on the fence line deal, say instead of the fence being on the neighbor's property, the fence came into the property you're looking at by 2 feet. Would you still say it was a potential problem?
I would. So the very good point. And let's have that conversation again. So if it's on the neighbor's property, I would probably check this one and say, hey, there could be a problem there. You are encroaching on your neighbor. But the neighbor's encroaching on this one. Depending on the severity, it may be this one or this one. If it's by a couple feet and they have worked out with the landowner or supposedly worked out with the landowner, and I have a letter from the landowner and stuff, I would probably check this one that the neighbor's property fence line is encroaching onto yours by so many feet. And just like I've said earlier and earlier many times, I'm going to have that conversation with the tribe, the agency, and I sign the certificate and my boss signs a certificate, the cadastral chief. I am going to have the conversation with the cadastral chief over, I think it's this box and this box is why. That way he is aware of it and he has his input there, so I don't get blindsided and say, no, it should have been this one. But a lot of times, I know one tribe, they have that survey done right away, if not on purchase. They are correcting all those issues going on. And I know one that I have coming down the pipe that it will probably be this one. There's a subdivision right next to their property, and I think the fence line is like a foot or two onto theirs. And if they can correct it, great. I don't think they can because it's been longstanding for a lot of time. I am going to check box this one and say why it's not. And what the tribe is still currently working on it. They may leave the legal description as it is, or they may correct the legal description and quick claim deed, and please make sure I talk about quick claim deeds in a minute. I don't have that part of my presentation, but that's something we should hit on. Quick claim deed, that other one. So we will try to work through those issues. And it's kind of, there's no real fine line on this. Some of them are very broad, and that goes between the tribe, what you're doing with the property, the bills, and the cadastral chief, and the severity. And, you know, in doing these, like I repeat again, having the conversation, having the relationship, everybody being on board and having the same idea how that's going to affect the property and the severity of it. So, good? So.
Hi, my name is Janet Wilkins. I'm with BLM Cadastral Survey. I wanted to make one quick comment on this. When you do your LDR request or LDR worksheet, there's a spot on there to say the reason that you're requesting it. That also comes into account when you're looking, when the cadastral surveyor is looking at these three boxes. If the purpose of the LDR, say it's for a grazing lease, the fence line Chris was talking about is minor, right? If the purpose of the LDR is to build a multi-million dollar casino or a housing subdivision, we're gonna go to the third box, because the purpose of the LDR, the purpose of the land transaction, has a much higher economic value, and the harm is much higher. The potential for harm is much higher. So the purpose of the LDR also affects which of these boxes are going to be checked because of the level of harm that could be caused. So I just wanted to add that real quick.
Thanks, Chris.
Very well said, and thank you. Yeah. Knowing what the property is used for, the economic value and stuff, is that very important, because, like you said, grazing, I mean, you can get by with a lot on that one. Rights of way or something like that will be standing for a long time. Yeah, I mean, that does definitely change it. So these are some of the information that can come out of the LDRs, and it can be in the request. So this one here, where you hit the check boxes, yes, it meets the standards for whether it's grazing or the multi-million. The comments, so I would put that there. This one, there's a check box in the request or the LDR or the worksheet on, you know, whether you want me to investigate the monuments, investigate the lines, and then updating the GCDB, and that one's tough without a survey. So, and then we're going to list the acreages, if not different, in how it was determined, whether it was GLO, official record, or by survey. Well, chain of survey, I'm not going to stay on a long time because we don't really use that one. We use a chain of title or whatever it is. It's a history of the surveys for that piece of property or the surrounding properties or the parent parcel. So you try to gather all those up. Some states it's easy because they've had recording laws for a long time, so you just go down to the county and you pay your money or you get the unofficial copies and you look at it. Some states they didn't get the recording, so it does take a lot longer. And it just shows the progression through there. And another part of that is the corner tie cards, where they've documented the information's on the corners and you can see them changing. So the certificate of inspection and possession. And 303 DM7 says a surveyor should be involved. They bring an expertise to them. So there's two forms. I'm not going over that because your BIA region dictates on and which one you're going to use them. So we're going to want to search for all the land records, search for recorded surveys, and physical inspection of them. And I, in Southern Plains, I really like to be involved in helping that out because that's me getting a chance to get closer to the property, actually get out on the ground and look at those issues, that seeing that, no, that was a hedgerow, or yes, that was farming on it, or there are no issues, or the fence lines out there. So I take my metal detector out there and try to find the corners to make sure everything's correct. A lot of times I don't sign them. A lot of times BIA officers sign them, but they have me a part of them. It's different for all the regions. Oh, this is the two forms. We're running short on time. So the field inspection, confirming the difference in the monuments and stuff like that. Make sure there's no trespasses, riparian issues, or anything else that could come up. Any questions? So, when we're considering this, we're wanting to walk the boundary with the surveyor and know the issues. Address any issues before the application. So that's having the consultation or getting to know the property before to do it. When you buy the property, I hope you have boots and eyes on the ground when you're out there buying it. You're out there walking it if you're not having the survey done, you know. And reading the LDR or whatever it is, and having the conversations if there are any issues on it, you know. And part of that is, you know, when I do my review, I got to have good copies of the records, and they got to be legible. So this came up in our region the other day and had an individual very upset. Part of the CIP is the boundary, looking at the boundary issues. And the gentleman was very upset because they had signed a certificate of inspection at 10 o'clock and it had been raining for a couple days. And he says, well, they couldn't have gone out and did the boundary portion of it. It needs to be rejected. And my argument to him is they had a survey done 2 months ago and everything's been updated. And he didn't like my answer, and he still doesn't like my answer. But so when you have the ALTA done, you've already have that portion of the certificate of inspection done, because he's went out there, walked the boundaries, he's went out there, made sure the monument's good, updated him, or whatever, or a recent boundary. You know, he's doing that. And if it's current, you know, and if it's relevant, if anything's changed, that changes all of these. So when you have the survey done and it's recent, you've already got this portion of the boundary certificate done. And part of that one is also going down to the county and having the records to make sure nothing has been put against that piece of property at the time, searching the records the day of or the day before you do the certificate of inspections. We're to the end. So, yeah, not bad. So we went over the history, you know, the fiduciary trust model, 303 DM7, the bills coming into effect in 2008. Knowing the guidance, so 303 came out. I work under the BLM manual, and whenever I do legal descriptions reviews, I turn to the specifications and I talk right out of there. And I cut and paste right out of there because that's, you know, that's what I'm supposed to follow by. And I try to stay to that as best as I can. And there are certain circumstances that we deviate for that. And I will put it in there why we deviated from that. So like Janet said earlier, hey, it's $1 million property. Guaranteed, I'm not going to deviate anywhere on those. But if it's for grazing and, you know, there's the boundary doesn't close by a couple feet, it's not that big of a deal. It's all driven by the purpose, the money, and all that. So, understanding the title insurance, you know, what they cover, what they don't cover. The difference in the surveys, not all surveys are done the same. The right tool for the right job, making sure that whether it's you need the full cadastral survey or you need having a CFEDS do a survey to bring it into trust where they're working toward the boundary standard evidence. They're doing all that work. They're filling out the worksheets for you or the requests. Or if you're just having an ALTA done because you're going to develop that property and you need a little more thorough survey. Or if it's just a chunk of land out there in the middle of nowhere, you have the right tool, which is just the regular boundary survey. But they should be, good surveyor is going to pull up all the adjoiners and stuff like that to make sure there's no conflicts in there. And then the second portion of it is me in my office or the Bills in their office trying to do all three of these the best we can using all the tools with your help providing us with all the information to get as close as we can to that primary source without actually doing it. So the risk is really greatly diminished up here and we start getting into higher risk of having issues. But in doing that, we're having all the information. We're taking our time. We're working through these, having those conversations to evaluate the risk on how the property should be used and what it's going to be used for. So, any questions? No?
I have one. When does it benefit?
When does it benefit to have a CFEDS as opposed to a local state surveyor? Which survey would benefit from that the most?
And that goes back to what you're doing. So let's talk about fee to trust real quick. So a fee to trust, it would probably behoove you to have the certified surveyor, the CFEDS, go out and do the work because he is trained in looking at those things, understanding how to fill out the paperwork or knowing the information you need to get it through the process. So, you know, and some of the CFEDS will put a whole packet together or get you close to doing it. And that sitting down and having that conversation is, okay, this is what I need. This is the deliverables I want. And having that back and forth and, oh, I can do this and do that. It's not just going and getting the bids on those and going with the cheaper one. Having that conversation, what they're offering, and having them put the packets and making sure that the joiners or whatever's in there. Because some of the surveyors, they will just get the first deed and go out and put it in the ground. And that's the $300 surveys or the $1,000 surveys. And that's not doing you any good. It's just making them money. So the CFEDS are supposed to be hired, supposed to be trained and knowledgeable about the federal way and getting things in a fee to trust. So,
you were going to talk about quit claim. What is the purpose of quit claim?
Quit claim deed. Legally and ethically, I can quit claim deed you this building. A quit claim deed, be very, very, very careful anytime you see a quit claim deed. And it's quit claim deed. I quit claim deed any interest, if any, into a piece of property and its interest. It may not be I own this property, I have interest in this property. I may not have interest in it. There may be a conflict in this. So I'm quit all my interest in this property to you, which may or may not be any. Sometimes it could be the whole property. A lot of times it's used when title and occupancy and stuff is in the question because it's not a warranty deed. I'm not warranting that I have any interest in this property. It's I may have interest in it. So anytime you see that, that should be a red flag to you when you're buying it. That means you want to do one of those things prior to buying it. You want to have the survey, or you want to have some kind of standard boundary evidence, or have the title insurance full blown on it, because of that happens, and it happens quite a bit. So I have a big trespass issue going on in Arizona. I do work for the Arizona Board of Technical Registration Enforcement Advisory Committee, and I review surveys and surveyors when I do things wrong. And we have a big case right now where a gentleman quitclaim deed over a piece of property, and he quitclaimed it over as the full 40, and he only had interest in 20 of those acres. And the buyer, carpe diem, buyer wasn't aware, and the surveyor wasn't aware of all the problems with that piece of property, and just throws the corners in the ground, and you know, the buyer's, you know, out those 20 acres. So we're after that surveyor's license right now. But any other questions? Cool. Well, thank you, guys.